Today we continue with all our knowledge on electronic structure and this local correlation DMFT, and first try to combine this DFT plus DMFT. And the second lecture we will go beyond. Yeah, that's our plan. Good. So for this lecture, so it's some kinds of realistic dynamical mean field theory for transition metal and F electron, rare earth, transuranium system. And then we discuss just specific problem of magnetism. Okay, so of course it's a technical and a little bit complicated, but coming back to nice reference from Albert Einstein. So everything should be made as simple as possible, but not simpler. So, and this Raka parameter and multiplet theory is pretty complicated and numeric. And also from magnetism, so there is interesting quotation from Feynman, from his lecture note, that this ferromagnetism is a beautiful and interesting problem for theoretical physics. So at the end, even this challenge here, why it exists, and why is a piece of lodestone or magnetite is in ground state ferromagnetic. So it's interesting question, but I can add, for example, there is even more interesting problem, why this correlated states of delta plutonium is non-magnetic. It's not, it was a big discussion, I'll later explain you, but we also, so it's the same question. So we know that this, again, weakly correlated metals in photo emission or in spectral function looks like this, but more correlated has this large incoherent path, and I said that all these materials have this large incoherent path. Again, our strength is that we are using functional and a different functional, and we discuss all these types of this functional. So already DFT we discussed, so now we discuss this combination of DFT plus DMFT. Okay, so what we want to combine? It's not a perfect marriage. You can find a better couple, and we know how to do this, but this was the first, and it's already quite successful. So density functional, even in LDA, is quite good for thousands of electrons. You know, any of your system has many, many electrons. And only 10% for some transition metal and rare earth is correlated with multiplet. So we don't want to do everything correlated. We cannot do it, wasting of time and resources. So we just do this atomic or correlated physics for only d electrons, and all the rest is just band structure. And we combine. And for these correlated materials, you will have this feature of this three-peak structure where you have a coherent quasi-particle, but also atomic-like multipliers which can form a low Hubbard and upper Hubbard band. This is Mickey Mouse picture, what we want to do. Okay, so how we combine this? Best things for both worlds. So was it first these two attempts, so from Anisimov and from our group, and in principle, exactly what we do. We just add some local correlated potential to density function. And it was preteacher of this method called LD plus U. It was also from Vladimir Anisimov. And you could view this as a static limit of this DMFT. So you have some static potential, which works only in correlated subspace. But if you go back to all electrons, there is complicated non-local potential. And even this was an interesting step forward. I will show you a few examples. But in this mode, in realistic DMFT, you will have energy dependent, so this local self-energy, which can describe a so-called paramagnetic insulator, or MOT insulator, which, of course, is much broader. If you have a short-range order, like in this vanadium compound, some clusterization, correlated crystallization, then you could do a cluster DMFT calculation. We will also discuss you soon. There is also a few first attempts. Good, so pictorially, yeah, what is the mechanism? So let's think about the simplest static LDA plus U calculation. So what we did, we start from full LDA, but for correlated electron, we put this Hubbard U operator. And if you look at famous this antiferromagnetic insulator like nickel oxide or manganese oxide, so if you do just DFT in local spin density approximation, system become antiferromagnetic, yeah. Even insulator, you see, you have a gap. So in the first glass, everything is perfect. But if you look at the gap, it's order of magnitude smaller than experiments. So gap in nickel oxide is about 4 eV. And you see, so what is this color? So this reddish color is a D-like bands, and this white is oxygen P-like bands. And so you see this gap, so this is zero, is a Fermi level, it's very small, 0.2 eV, and experiments is 4. And here we just do this computer experiments, we just increase this U parameter. And as soon as you increase this U parameter, you see that occupied part of D band goes down, and unoccupied part goes up. So you have this Hubbard splitting of occupied and unoccupied states. And this is already half step to correct physics of this correlated oxide. So you see now, first of all, you could immediately understand that you change a character of your gap. And experimentalists know this for a long time. So they said that this oxide is not a MOT insulator, but MOT insulator is you have a gap between D states. Yeah? So this is a MOT insulator with a small gap. But here it's so-called charge transfer insulator. So because here near the Fermi level occupied states is predominantly oxygen P, and unoccupied is this unoccupied D. So you see, because D state goes below P, you have change of character of this your insulating state. So also interesting. Okay, so the same happens in magnesium. If you look at so-called exchange interaction, you could measure this spin wave spectrum. Here you have experiments on bottom. And if you start from LDA, you see, you overestimate energy of your spin wave excitation by, let's say, factor of 5, order of magnitude. And if you increase U, you almost can go back to experimental, just magnon spectrum. So see this, you could calculate magnon spectrum for this compound with some U, which is of order of 10 eV. Good. So if you do real dynamical mean field theory for this realistic materials, then you have a lot of quantum local fluctuation. You have orbital fluctuation, you have spin fluctuation, you have also charge fluctuation locally, but only locally. And then you could formulate this DMFT self-consistent condition. We'll discuss it probably once more later. And do realistic calculation. But you need a machinery to combine this all-electron so-called density function with only correlated electron, some small subset of your dynamical mean field object. And the best way to of doing this is of course so-called projection formulas. We project all states to substates of correlated, and then we project back. So L is like localized correlated subspace. G is like this plane where you could think all states. And so we assume that they're orthogonal for many body formulation. And you form some projection operator, and we are very lucky because it's already in one of the standard computer code, so it's already this projection. It's exactly this WASP projected plane wave. So they have already this operator, which projects the full basis to some localized. And then you use this projector just to go from, this is a full green function inverse. You just put from both sides this projector. You form this local green function for correlated states. Yeah, then you could solve some DMFT equation in local basis set, find this self-energy, which will be also matrix in your orbital, and then you project back to full. And then you add. And then you go back and forth and do self-consistent calculation. So it's just some pictorial view how all this many-body LDA plus DMFT package looks like. So you have some DFT part, you have DMFT part, you have this projector, and then you go back and forth to correlated impurity solver and go back. So the main progress is just to realize that for D, it means that 5D orbital on F, 7F orbital, you already can do this quantum impurity simulation thanks to this new method Rubtsov invented from this continuous time and so on and so forth. Good. So what about you? Hardy Gross always, who liked DFT but not like DMFT, he said, life without you, this you. And in Dutch, you is exactly big U, Z. okay, so what about you? So how you parameterize this? The simplest parameterization is, this was historically was first to use, it's like atomic-like parameterization. You know from atomic physics that this Coulomb, local Coulomb interaction for this orbital, you could expand in so-called Slater or Ricard parameter. So how you do this? You just write spherical expansion for this Coulomb interaction and put this in matrix elements, and then you get a Coulomb matrix element proportional to so-called this FK, it's Slater parameter. It's just radial integral between this object, and some complicated angular path from 3J symbols, but you can tabulate this object. It's big, but simple. And parameter is this Slater parameter. So you need only three parameter for D states or four parameter for F state. It's renormalized because there is a screening in solids, but you could guess. Later, we realized that you could do this really to calculate screening in simplest like GW approximation. So we calculate screen Coulomb interaction using this polarizability of all electrons, but didn't take into account screening from D electron because you can do this late. And then using this screen Coulomb interaction, you calculate also matrix elements and calculate this U matrix. And this is a comparison of this Slater parameterization with this RPA-like. And you already see the difference because in atom the Coulomb interaction is spherical, in solid it's like cubic. And you see these additional terms coming out, and even diagonal, this main contribution. So here there is a 5D states for local 5D orbital spherical sense, they are all equal, yeah. But in cubic, you see this, there is some 3T2G and 1EG. So you clearly see the breaking of symmetry, it's a cubic symmetry, and, yeah. But we can work with this matrix. So this is all Coulomb matrix now, not only one parameter U, but some numerical matrix. And this is screen interaction. Of course, it depends on frequency, but since the bandwidth of d electrons is about 4, in scale of a bandwidth is pretty constant, so you can use a constant U. Good, so we know how to calculate U. This is one of the first calculation from Dieter Folhart and Anisimov. So they choose this vanadite, because there is a nice experiment. So this is a theoretical spectrum. And you see this three-peak structure also. And this is a photo emission. So photo emission measure only occupied part, but if you put this spectral function together with photo emission, so you see quite nice agreement. It was a big progress in understanding of this correlated material. Okay, so we already mentioned is another important properties is not only Hubbard U in real materials, there is also Hund J. Probably you again remember from your quantum mechanic that there is this, Hund exchange effects in this D shell or something. I will explain why. And so starting from, let's say, last 5 years, it was a great attention to this Hund's material, especially related with new superconductor, this pnictite superconductor. Pnictite is based on iron, and iron has a large Hund's exchange, so there is not much of mod physics, but a lot of Hund's physics. And again, so this is the same diagrams, it's now T2G test. T2G is a three orbital test. So three orbital, you could have zero electron. Let me put here. Zero electron, one, two, three, four, till six. Yeah. And you see that at half field case, it's much, much easier to get insulated. Because again, three electron due to Hund's rule will try to be all in collinear, parallel. So you need very little U to go to insulating state. Funny enough, you could parameterize your Coulomb interaction. It's written here, yeah? But it's only for three orbital. For five orbital, you cannot write exactly such. You parameterize like, this is really Hubbard-like terms, like N square. Then you have first Hund's rule, which is minus some parameter times S square. And then you see this first Hund's rule that S want to be maximized, yeah? But you also have this term J half L square. So this is a second Hund's rule. If the S is maximized, then you also want to maximize L, its orbital. And you see, there is no quantum mechanic textbooks with they discuss this Hund's rules, but this is much easier to say that, for simple three orbital model, you could exactly rewrite this, and then you see this. And you see that this coefficient in front of L square is just one quarter of this Hund's rule. So everything is fine. And with this interaction, they calculate this phase diagram. Okay, who is Hund? I think this is a Frederick Hund.
It's the same person, right?
Hmm?
It's the It's all the same person.
No. he came from this famous group of Max Born in Göttingen. So Max Born is a person who, in my opinion, start quantum mechanics. So he's pushing and fighting with Einstein. Also, they were good friends. So the first assistant was in Göttingen was Wolfgang Pauli. The second assistant was Werner Heisenberg, and he was write this first seminal paper on quantum mechanics. And then it was two PhD students, Pascal Jordan and Friedrich Hund. And this is the same Friedrich Hund with Max Born in 50s, when already Max Born got a Nobel Prize. So all these people got a Nobel Prize, not only Pascal Jordan, because he was not a correct political orientation, how to say. And also Friedrich Hund didn't get, because he... But when Max Born left Göttingen, Friedrich Hund got his position. So, and it's also interesting, this is a golden age of this time, on 20s, it's called Bonzen. So two Nobel Prizes, this is Max Born, and this is Frank, this is James Frank, Frank Condon effect. Good, so Hund is clear, and this is from a few PhD students from Hamburg. So, and the same collaboration with photoemission. So now we do remember this. We first discussed photoemission of one iron atom in different substrates. Here we have one substrate. Yeah, it's silver, but different transition metal. And this is photoemission spectrum experiments from the same group, Italian group of Carlo Carbone. And this is our theoretical interpretation. So you see, if you go from so this transition element, manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, all the spectrum looks completely different. And the difference is coming from this Hund's rule physics. So in the simplest approximation, if you calculate some effective parameter for different occupation, that you know that effective parameter for half-field case will be this U times 4J. Yeah? This is why you need only very small U to get mod insulator. This is exactly this point, yeah, half field point. But if you go just one step left and right, so if you have N6 or, yeah, then effective U change drastically. And then this is exactly this is a half field case, manganese. This is why you have this like only Hubbard band. But here, for iron, you have almost three peak structure. Yeah, this very small effective U, you have quasiparticle and Hubbard band. For cobalt, you have this multiplet structure, which we already discussed, you could see this. And for nickel, yeah, you have almost like renormalized band structure. Good. So this is, again, pictorial view of different types of correlated materials. If it's only single orbital, then you have a Hubbard physics with a three peak structure. So low Hubbard, quasi-particle, upper Hubbard. If you have a strong Hund's effect, then you have some pseudo-gap from this quasi-particle due to spin splitting. But there is elements where all Coulomb parameters are important, we call this Raka metals, where you have both quasi-particle and lot of multiplets. One famous example, okay, this is Raka, again, to see. So this is Guido Raka, who first tried to diagonalize just atomic Coulomb interaction. So he did it in You see, in 1942, working in Jerusalem, and close to Jerusalem, it was already German tanks around. So it was a very bad time, but he just...
Jerusalem that time was what it was, English protectorate?
Yeah, but German tried to occupy it. And I think he was even fighting with him. Okay, so funny enough, so he was born in Italy, and was, so you see, this is Raqqa, and this is, guess what is this? It's a Fermi. So he was a student of Fermi in University of Rome. And of course, he did a lot of this Raqqa operator with this double irreducible tensor. And in this 1942, he diagonalized all atomic multiplets analytically using a lot of symmetry and so on. Nowadays, of course, we are lazy. We just calculate Coulomb interaction, diagonalize this, and we get the same multiplet. Good. But one of interesting example of this Raqqa effect, all multiplets materials, was plutonium. So this is a phase diagram of plutonium, famous in the 50s, because both Americans and Russians tried to understand the physical properties. Maybe 10 years ago, they still fighting about the phase diagram, because it's not easy materials to make these all experiments. But finally, everybody agrees that this phase, so Russian phase diagram, was correct. So plutonium has a lot of allotropes, something like 7. You see this alpha, beta, gamma, delta, delta prime, epsilon. This already, you could understand that there is something which makes this lot of phase transition. So it's this correlation effect in F shell. And one of these famous phases is so-called this delta phase. It's very simple. It's just FCC phase. And again, this is all transuranium element, and you already see that plutonium is very special. And if you look at volume, so you already, as function of these different materials, you see that something happens between alpha and delta plutonium. It's a big jump. So this jump is about 30% of volume. And this, there is a almost consensus, but that this localization of this F states happens, this mode transition for delta plutonium. Okay, another interesting experimental property is that if you measure spectral function, it's just density of states, for delta plutonium or for plutonium compounds, you see this three-peak structure. It's different from this DMFT three-peak structure because it's only an occupied path. But you see, you have this very sharp something like quasi-particle just below Fermi level, and plus additional two states which coming from multiplet structure. But you clearly see this. Good. So this is the recent theoretical calculation from our collaborator from Prague, Indra Kolarens. So you need to use a special solver to do all this multiplet and a bus. So he used a Lancers, because in this case you don't need analytical continuation back. But nowadays even Monte Carlo solver can reproduce. But in any case, so this is again experimental photoemission spectrum green, and this is this F electron states near Fermi level. And you see this, clearly see this three-peak structure. And
there's a big difference in tails, or the graph is just shifted up. the green one.
Ah, this?
Yes.
This is experiment. Experiments always have some.
Why do they have this?
Oh.
What does it
do? So they have another 10,000 electrons.
So it comes from.
From SP. And, yeah, yeah. But it's called background. So sometimes it's just subtract background, photoemission background. So always good. So you could also formulate in a K space. So this is really spectral function, it's function of K. And then you see that you have these F states, and this is this 1, 2, and 3 peak. And this peak is non-dispersive. And because it's non-dispersive, it shows it's atomic-like multiplets. There is very interesting problem, I said. In all these phase diagrams, this delta plutonium is non-magnetic. There is a lot of fighting if it's magnetic or non-magnetic, but finally they almost agree that ground states of this delta plutonium is non-magnetic. And it's not trivial to understand why it's non-magnetic. Because if you look at this, our calculations, there is a two multiplets which contribute to ground states. So one is F5 electrons, which almost 80%, and another is F6, which 20%. And this is this atomic multiplets from F5 and F6. Would it be only S6, then it's no problem. S6 has ground states singlet, multiply. But it's a mixture. It's like a mixed valence between this and this. 20% of that, 20%. In atoms, this F5 is magnetic. But because of this mixture, because of the fast quantum fluctuation, so the ground states become non-magnetic. And it's still not well proof and understandable. But there is, I said, there is experimental rule that if you have a mixed valence compound and one state is non-magnetic, another is magnetic, final solution will be non-magnetic. So it's still worthwhile to explore this. Good, and there is some our simple understanding. So you have this two configuration, F5 and N6, and you need a mixture, quantum mixture. And we know that F6 is singlet. This is why it's only singlet-like combination of F5 which can mix. And this is, in fact, very, very similar to so-called this variational approach called Varma-Yaffet. For Conda. Oh. So we need to tell Jenny about this old paper. There is some variation on that for Conda. Good. And there is a lot of these states F5, and they form this singlet mixture with F6. Good. So plutonium. And another example, I just want to show you this maybe too famous example, was the magnetism. So following proposal of Richard Feynman, we try to understand why this transition metal, iron, cobalt, nickel, is ferromagnetic. So you see they are very similar, and this is color very similar, but Curie temperature is very different. So iron is about 1,000 Kelvin Curie temperature, nickel 600. So problem is classical, more than 2,000 years, because you've heard that even these ancient people know about this lodestone. And there is three main theoretical understanding. So the oldest one was a mean field. It has name as Stoner model. It's like a mean field model, where you have like non-interacting electron which just split in effective field. And if you increase temperature, the splitting decrease, and in critical temperature, you lose splitting. So it's a mean field, simplest mean field theory. Then there is purely localized theory from Heisenberg, where you have a local moment, and above Curie temperature they are disorder, below Curie temperature they are collinear. And the most realistic system or theory for this itinerant iron is Hubbard-like model, where you both have local moment, disordered local moment, and also change of orientation and value. So it's like a combination of both. And why so? Because this magnetic electrons is a 3D electrons from iron. And you know that they participate to local moment, to Curie vice, so it means that they, from one hand, they are quasi-localized, but from other hands, so these D electrons are also itinerant. They participate to Fermi surface. You could measure Fermi surface and see that there is a part of Fermi surface that belongs to D electron. Okay, and if you do this LDA plus DMFT calculation as function of temperature, you could somehow see this effect that at low temperature you have local moment, then there is some critical temperature, ferromagnetic, and even above critical temperature you have Curie vice, 1 over T, and with magnetic moment, which is reasonable size. 10 years later, maybe we did, so this first calculation was with old Monte Carlo and very simple density-density interaction parameter. Now we repeated the same iron and nickel with the full Coulomb parameter and using continuous time quantum Monte Carlo. But qualitatively it's the same. So if you use this density-density, you just get a factor of two higher Curie temperature. It was in all calculation exactly the same. If you go to more realistic Coulomb correlation, you go to experimental even Curie temperature. So nickel you just even go a little bit lower. But in principle, you see that we can describe this ferromagnetism. What about spectral properties? So this is a comparison of density functional with this realistic DMFT. You see this spectrum become much broader. And especially for nickel, it was a famous three problem for density functional, and you could somehow overcome this. So the bandwidth was 30% larger in density functional. Now the bandwidth is reduced drastically. Spin splitting was twice larger. You reduce also almost by factor of two. And there is a many-body satellite infrared emission spectrum, which you could also reproduce. This many-body satellite is some kind of low Hubbard band. Okay, so it's also quite good. And this is this new spectral with the continuous time Monte Carlo, thanks to Lёша. And you see that results are very good. K-dependent spectral function. And I also learned this from photoemission experimentalists, mainly again from Carlo Carbone, that it was a problem with so this is a photoemission, dots of photoemission, and this color plot is a spectral function from our realistic DMFT calculation. So this is spin up and this is spin down. So you see spin down, you have K-dependent spectral density, and it's quite good agreement. Spin up, so you see this part is K-dependent, but there is some branch which in experiments they couldn't even find where is the band. So it's very broad. And in calculation is also very broad, and where it come from. If you look at the self-energy, so this is self-energy, and you see that self-energy exactly at this, you know, energy from, let's say, minus 3 electron volts, you have a very strong imaginary path. So due to local self-energy, all these bands is just wash out. Dispersion wash out, and they're very broad. So you see that this path has a very, very important local correlations, has very important consequences on this ARPIS experiment. This is the same experiment from Carlo Carbone, but from all transition metal. It's even not published, he just gave me. And you see this development of all these D bands, starting from copper, where the D band is completely filled, and this is S, and then this D band go to Fermi level. But the most strange object is this manganese. You see, again, it has almost a dispersive band. And long time ago, when we discussed with him, this is low Hubbard band again. And long time ago, so Zilke Biermann, when this was even a PhD, so she did this LDA plus DMFT calculation and almost finds this undispersive band, which is low Hubbard band. This is experiments and several. Since we discuss Heisenberg model and Ising model, so let's understand where this exchange interaction in ferromagnets or antiferromagnets come from. It was the first successful application of quantum mechanics almost. So this is a paper of Werner Heisenberg in 1928. So to theory of ferromagnetism. And you see this first capital is method along the Pauli. So exchange interaction is just combination of Pauli principle, so anti-symmetrized wave function, and Coulomb interaction. And Heisenberg just was the first to realize it. By the way, this Pauli was invented, his principle in Hamburg, in our institute, so, and this he was still visiting Hamburg. And this is exchange interaction, So you see it's really exchange integral, which we know from atomic physics with Coulomb interaction. But how to do this for real materials in the same parameter? So first, let's discuss a different thinking and understanding of simplest model of two-side molecule, H2 or Hubbard molecule. And it's also interesting to realize what is a different problem. Heisenberg just said that there is a two states of this molecule, singlet and triplet, and exchange interaction he defined as a half of the distance between singlet and triplet. Then Slater came and said, it's true, but we can from other heads also form this simple single Slater determinant, and one determinant will be like ferromagnetic, and another is like antiferromagnetic, which is not a ground state. But still, if you understand that energy of this antiferromagnetic states is just a half singlet minus triplet, so exactly the same exchange interaction you could calculate as antiferromagnetic minus ferromagnetic energy state. This was one thinking. Another was from, of course, P.W. Anderson, so Anderson model. He says that main contribution in Hubbard model, so-called super exchange interaction or kinetic exchange, where in second order process this electron goes here, at some Coulomb interaction goes back. It's this famous 2t square over u. How you could understand this? You could understand this just doing exact diagonalization. Yeah? So if you go to the sector of these two electrons with one electron per two side, this sector of singlet sector has four states, and there is a ground states. So there is this lowest singlet and triplet states has exact this energy in Hubbard model. If you expand singlet energy in order of t over u, you get exactly this 4t square over u, and half distance between singlet and triplet is exactly this Anderson super exchange. You could do exactly the same exercise in much easy way. You do this just a mean field like, yeah? But not to get total energy difference, you calculate stiffness of mean field like model, very simple mean field model. And if you calculate stiffness, you get exactly the same answer. So we use this simple idea. And of course, you could also calculate this magnetic susceptibility in density functional, this standard formulation. And you could reformulate also in some kinds of exchange interactions. This was done by Mishukas and so on. But what I would like to point out that as soon as you go to so-called Higgs phase, yeah, what is Higgs phase? That you have well-defined local magnetic moment, that exchange interaction is just a stiffness in this Goldstone direction of this moment. And this stiffness you could calculate easily, yeah, like even second order perturbation, and there is a lot of cancellation in density functional and also in Baim-Kadanov. And finally, you get just a single particle contribution. Yeah? So an exchange interaction looks like, you know, non-local susceptibility in spin-polarized case. So G up, G down. It's exactly this Higgs phase. And if you calculate this in density functional, you get quite nice result for all exchange interaction for transition metal. And you also understand, because this is a second moment of a Green function, and there is this old theorem in tight binding that second moment should have two poles as function of occupation. So exactly this half field case would have anti-ferromagnetic exchange interaction, and close to field case is ferromagnetic. So you see, you could put all this iron, cobalt, nickel in the right ferromagnetic position, and we know that manganese and chromium is anti-ferromagnetic. So we can understand this magnetism of metal. Good, and nowadays you could even calculate this exchange parameter for very complicated system like this molecular magnet. I don't know if you've heard about this materials where you have this 12 manganese atom in this surrounding of all chemists, very complicated chemists, and they could estimate exchange interaction. We can calculate, and it's quite reasonable. Good, so finally, for maybe this part, I want to discuss short-range correlation. And in next lecture, we will go to long-range correlation. So the short, if you have not only local correlation, but little bit, you know, above single side, then you could just generalize DMFT to some local object called cluster. And this was with the name cluster DMFT. They have different name like dynamical cluster approximation. And this was the first people who discussed. So again, you have lattice, but suppose you have a strong coupling between nearest neighbor. Then, of course, it's useful to choose a small cluster and integrate it out again all the rest. Yeah, and then you have a small cluster in a matrix bus, and you know, just can do this similar machinery of so-called cluster DMFT approach. Okay, and one interesting example. Now we go slowly back to more model and model calculation because machinery is very complicated, and all this non-local interaction correlation is also one or two bands model. There is old and complicated problem of phase transition between magnetic states exactly and singlet states. And this is one of realization of this. It's called double beta lattice. So you see you have beta. So you have one beta lattice and another beta lattice which couple via perpendicular hopping. So single beta lattice is exact solution as we discussed for dynamical mean field theory. What is this double beta lattice? It was old paper by Andrei Rubinstein, and it was from the same Rutgers University as the Cutler, and was he has a nice this idea that if you have this lattice, double beta lattice, then exact solution of this double beta lattice is a cluster DMFT. This is a Hamiltonian, so you have lattice A and lattice B in D infinity with local Coulomb interaction and also hopping, perpendicular hopping between these two lattices. Good. And so now you could form this cluster Green function, so this little molecules, yeah, they are all equivalent, and form a self-consistent cluster DMFT calculation. And so this is nothing else but hybridization delta parameter, which in a beta lattice has a particularly simple form, like this beta hopping times local Green function. So you could understand this, that there is only closed loop in beta lattice. So if you go out of this closed loops, you never come back. So the only one probability is also this T squared times zero. And you see already, so this simple lattice has an interesting phase transition where perpendicular hopping is square root of this beta hopping. And the ground states for T perp equal to zero is, as we already discussed, is antiferromagnetic beta lattice because it's bipartite lattice. Yeah? You can form this antiferromagnetic. But if you go to this critical T perp, so you see that magnetization is disappeared. So the question is what happens? And of course it's clear that for very, very large T perp, it's much easier to form this local singlet of this old pair. And this singlet has no local magnetic moment. And this is this phase transition. And it's a quite interesting phase transition. So this is all phase diagram of this T perp and U. For small U, of course, you don't have this dimer. You have paramagnetic metal. Then you could have antiferromagnetic metal. But if you, U is large, you exactly has a transition as function of T perp between antiferromagnetic insulator and so-called this singlet insulator. And this is how it looks like in a density of states. So this is a two different U, so small U and large U, and different perpendicular hopping. For small perpendicular hopping, you have antiferromagnetic states. So you can see this from density of states. So red is spin up, blue is spin down. But if you increase perpendicular hopping, T perp, you immediately get some this non-magnetic density of states, which is signature of singlet formation. Quite good. This was one things. And okay, so let's so the summary from this part is that thanks to this very efficient impurity solver with continuum time Monte Carlo, it is possible now easily solve 5-orbital or 7-local quantum impurity model and do all this complicated LDA plus TMFT calculations. Good. So if you have maybe question to this, let's answer, and then we go to last part, which is this.
Easily nowadays.
Okay. Easily means that there is, there's a lot of, let's say, in quote, a standard combination. So you could choose a most accurate density functional package, like this Win2K. There is also package which make a connection between this band structure, this projector connection, and local impurity model, and can do this self-consistent. But for local impurity model, normally with 5 or even 7 orbital, you use this strong coupling expansion. And there are very efficient at least 2 packages. One is this ALPS and other tricks. There is also versions. So easily means that you need.
How many postdocs you need and how many computer?
No. It's not even postdoc. No. This it was 5 years ago. Maybe it's postdoc. Nowadays. It's even good master students can do this. And it's not, of course, he need to be skillful to understand the complicated computer program. But interesting things is like this many body localization. In if something goes wrong, even with students, so the results is so bad that you immediately understand it is bad. So there is only small region of a good. I can look in 1 second and when students is good, they could do this.
And what's the computer?
Computer power. You need some like 50-100 processor for a few hours. That's it. It's normal. So. In Hamburg, we have very good local computer center. Sometimes it's even better than supercomputer because you know this.
It's yours.
Yeah. Supercomputer, there is a slop time for 24 hours, but you could on weekend put big jobs, and on Monday you have self-consistent plutonium calculation. Yeah, it's true. So it's miracle how fast. This computer program and will develop. So about this 98, 2000, it was means that 20 years ago It was not easy to understand because all the calculation in DMFT was this model calculation. And only a few groups, so we realized that computers are so powerful already that you could do not one band, but five band calculations. And this is a big step, yeah? That you could do not only model, but some nice realistic material, understand what is different between iron and nickel and so. Yeah, I think progress is very fast, both in solver, in physical understanding, and in computer code.